this morning. We're going to remember the love that's been given to us, the salvation that we have in Him, the life that's been poured out by the Father. So would you sing with me this morning? Let's sing Amazing Grace.
An amazing grace, amazing grace, that far outweighs my past mistakes. Your death became the death of shame. I'll praise you for amazing grace. Up from the grave, up from the grave, into the dark, you called.
Sing out your praise. Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Gabby Baltazar, and I serve on staff with Harvest Kids and Young Adults at the Elgin campus. I'm so glad you joined us. We would love to know where you are watching from today. Let us know in the chat or in the comments. And if this is your first time with us, I want to especially welcome you. No matter where you're joining us from today, we're so glad you're here. Whether you're new or you come every week, we want to invite you to check in. You can do that on this page through a link in the comments or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We would love to know you're here today and how we can be praying for you this week. We wanted to remind you that three sources of information are always on the Harvest website. First, elder updates. From the most recent to the past 6 months, you can find them under About Our Elders. Second, as part of the commitment of our finance committee to provide greater transparency, our monthly financial statements can be found under Church Updates on the website. And finally, ongoing information about the lead teaching pastor search can be found on the homepage under Teaching, Lead Teaching Pastor Search. We hope this helps you locate information that's important to the Harvest family. Do you ever think, wouldn't it be great to work for the Lord at Harvest? Maybe now it's the time. We have a number of open positions right now. If you're interested or know someone who is, go to harvestnow.info for more details. Lifting high the name of Jesus together in worship. What could be better? Worship nights return on Thursday, February 11th at 7:30 p.m. at the Rolling Meadows campus. Everyone is welcome. If you're not able to join us in person, you can watch online at harvestbiblechapel.org. Malachi 3:10 says, "Bring the full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and thereby put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there is no more need." Wow, we can never outgive the Lord. To assist you with your faithful giving to the Lord, you can give online on this page, or you can also hold the camera to your phone up to the QR code on this screen, and it will take you directly to the giving page on the Harvest website. You can give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, through a text, or by mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for the day that you have given us. I pray, Father, that you may open our hearts to receive today's message and bless those around in the surrounding Chicagoland area, Lord. We thank you for your goodness to us and allow us to dwell in your presence today as we open up your word. We pray this in your name. Amen.
say, hallelujah, our God reigns. Amen. Psalm 121. Psalm 21 says, I lift my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. We believe in the power of prayer. We believe that right now, when God's people are gathered, that He's here with us. And that when we come into this house, this is a house of prayer. So we're going to take a minute again this morning. I'd like to invite everyone, if you're in this room or you're online, would you just lean into this moment? We're going to pray a prayer out loud as a congregation. I'd like to do something a little bit unique. God has called us to be an outward-facing people, to live our allegiance to King Jesus in an outward-facing way, that we would be a light to the world, that we hope it would bring life and encouragement to the people who He's put in our circles of influence. And so right now, what I'm going to invite you to do is, before we pray this prayer, would you get your phone out? And if there's somebody who needs prayer in your life right now, would you record this moment, text it to them, send it to them? We're going to be praying for them as a church right now. Or maybe you just call them right now, have them on speakerphone, let them hear the room. But we're going to come as the people of God before the Lord, because we believe that He hears us. We believe that when we fix our eyes on Him, He gives us vision to see things like He does. That He gives us wisdom when we don't know what to do. And we want to pray that over others as well.
Oh, yeah.
So church, let's pray this together in agreement. Would you pray out loud with me? Here we go. Father, we gather together and come into agreement in the powerful name of Jesus. We know according to Your word that where two or more are gathered in Your name, You will be among them. We know that You are not limited by time or distance, and that You desire for Your people to lift their eyes to You to find their strength. We trust that You are a good Father who listens and longs to answer the prayers of Your children. So in faith, we pray with one voice on behalf of each person listening to this prayer. For those who are afraid, God, You are their refuge and strength, an ever-present help in times of trouble. Let them rest in the promise that You will never leave them or forsake them. For those who are overwhelmed or anxious and are in a season of waiting, we know that the very hands that place the stars in the heavens are the same hands that are holding every outcome. You offer a peace beyond what the world offers, a peace that transcends all understanding. Let that peace transform their hearts and minds as they choose to trust You. For those that are in despair, the tired, the weary, the weak, You are close to the brokenhearted and crushed in spirit. You are the lifter of their heads. You bind up wounds and heal diseases. Your promises give life. Would You send a fresh outpouring of Your Spirit to be their comforter and to restore to them the joy of salvation and a hope that is only found in Christ? For those who need victory, let them draw near to the throne of grace, reminding them that only You can break through any stronghold, any addiction, any bondage. Your power is perfected in their weakest moments. You are their defender and have already won their battle. We entrust all these prayers to You, God, the one who reigns over all creation, who sits on a holy throne, who hears the prayers of his people, who can make all things work together for good, for those who are called according to your purpose. You promise to supply all our needs according to your glorious riches, given to us in the one whose name we pray, Christ Jesus. And all God's people together said, amen. 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 Let it be so, Lord. Let's sing.
Hallelujah, our God reigns. And hallelujah, our God reigns. Yeah. Oh, hallelujah, our God reigns. Forever all my days, hallelujah. You are. It's who you are.
remain the same. Can the church say amen?
Yeah, that's right.
His love remains the same. If you agree with that, church, won't you just lift your hands and open your mouth and give God the best praise you got? If you know anything about his love, lift your hands and open your mouth and give him the best praise you got.
Talk to your people. You lift our heads when we're discouraged. You remind us of your truth. So would you do that again right now through your word as we come? We give you authority in our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You guys, can we just give it up one more time? Go ahead and take a seat this morning.
Well, it's great to be with you again all across these six campuses. I am so, so happy to be with you. We're going to keep warm, even though it's cold outside, and we'll be warmed, I hope, by studying the Word of God together. I was wondering if, like me, you sometimes feel a little bit like Bob in the movie What About Bob, when he says, "I'm in really bad shape. Come on, please, give me. I need. Well, most of the time, we're really not like Bob. Most of the time, we're not neurotically needy. But if any of us were really asked, we do have needs sometimes in life that still need to be met, and we long for them to be met, and we're disappointed with God that it seems like he hasn't met our needs. Some of our needs have to do with money. I need more money, we might say. I need money to pay off the mortgage. I need money to buy a new house. I need money to buy new clothes. I need money to pay the rent. I need money. Sometimes we think we just don't have enough. Sometimes our needs have to do with relationships. I need a mate, a husband or a wife. I need to restore the relationship with my husband or my wife. I need God to restore a relationship with my kids. I need to have a kid. We are looking for relationships and we feel like there are needs that need to be met. And sometimes our needs are really personal. We might say, I need peace of mind, particularly in this time of COVID. I need confidence in you. I need hope. When we feel disappointed with the world, when we feel disappointed with God, I believe it highlights our needs. It makes us want to have those needs met. And when they are not, we feel especially disappointed with God. I believe the answers to finding hope in a disappointing world, particularly about how our needs will be met, which is what we're going to talk about today, is found in the book of Ruth. Let's do a little review. The theme, again, of the book of Ruth is how to find hope in a disappointing world. Last week, we talked about chapter 1, which showed Ruth's determined faith. It taught us that we need to have a determined faith. Today, we're going to talk about a diligent faith. And next week, we'll talk about a dependent faith. And then in week 4 of this series, we're going to talk about a delivering faith. But I want to give you 4 words to help you remember the book of Ruth, 1 for each chapter. Chapter 1 is weeping. Chapter 2 is working. Chapter 3 is waiting. And chapter 4, remember the word wedding. So we've covered weeping. That was last week. We're going to talk about working today, diligent faith. And as we look at this, we wonder about how we feel that God has not met our needs and we're disappointed. We think that God hasn't come through for us. We ask, how will our needs actually be met? And I believe in Ruth chapter 2, it teaches us that God will meet our needs. Maybe in ways that we don't expect, but he does meet our needs. Turn in your Bibles if you have them. I hope you do have them. Don't take out just little computers or phones. It's better always to have paper and ink, in my opinion. Of course, you can, if you have anything, use it in terms of scripture. But I really want to encourage you, take out your Bible and follow along in Ruth chapter 2. Now, Naomi had a relative on her husband's side named Boaz. He was a prominent man of noble character from Elimelech's family. Ruth the Moabitess asked Naomi, "Will you let me go into the fields and gather fallen grain behind someone who allows me to?" Naomi answered, "Go ahead, my daughter." So Ruth left and entered the field to gather grain behind the harvesters. She happened to be in the portion of land belonging to Boaz, who was from Elimelech's family. Later, when Boaz arrived from Bethlehem, he said to the harvesters, "The Lord be with you." "The Lord bless you," they replied. Boaz asked his servant, who was in charge of the harvests, "Whose young woman is this?" The servant answered, "She's the young Moabite woman who returned with Naomi from the land of Moab." She asked, "Will you let me gather fallen grain among the bundles behind the harvesters?" She came and has remained from early morning until now, except that she rests a little in the shelter. Then Boaz said to Ruth, "Listen, my daughter, don't go and gather grain in another field, and don't leave this one, but stay here close to my female servants. See which field they are harvesting and follow them. Haven't I ordered the young men not to touch you? When you're thirsty, go and drink from the jars the young men have filled." She bowed with her face to the ground and said to him, "Why are you so kind to notice me, although I am a foreigner?" Boaz answered her, "Everything you have done for your mother-in-law since your husband's death has been fully reported to me. How you left your father and mother and the land of your birth, and how you came to a people you didn't previously know. May the Lord reward you for what you have done. And may you receive a full reward from the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge." "My lord," she said, "you've been so kind to me. For you have comforted and encouraged your slave, although I am not like one of your female servants. At mealtime, Boaz told her, come over here and have some bread and dip it in the vinegar sauce. So she sat beside the harvesters and he offered her roasted grain. She ate and was satisfied and had some left over. When she got up to gather grain, Boaz ordered his young men, let her even gather grain among the bundles and don't humiliate her. Pull out some stalks from the bundles for her and leave them for her to gather. Don't rebuke her. So Ruth gathered grain in the field until evening. She beat out what she had gathered and was about 26 quarts of barley. She picked up the grain and went into the town where her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. When she brought out what she had left over from her meal and gave it to her, then her mother-in-law said to her, where did you gather barley today and where did you work? May the Lord bless the man who noticed you. Ruth told her mother-in-law about the men she had worked with and said, the name of the man I'd worked with today is Boaz. Then Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, may he be blessed by the Lord who has not forsaken his kindness to the living or the dead. Naomi continued, the man is a close relative. He is one of our family redeemers. So Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, my daughter, it is good for you to work with his female servants so that nothing will happen to you in another field. Ruth stayed close to Boaz's female servants and gathered grain until the barley and the wheat harvests were complete. She lived with her mother-in-law. Well, this is a terrific passage because it reminds us about how God meets our needs. And the very first way that God meets our needs, as found in this passage, is through obedience to God's word. Now, there's a new character that appears in this story. He's a man of standing. He's called over here when he appears right away. It says that he was a man of noble character. And this is a significant aspect of him. In Hebrew, it's very, very significant. It means a man of integrity, a man of character, a mighty man of valor is what it's described as. And Ruth decides to go to glean. She asks her mother, she says, can I go glean? And she, mother-in-law, and she goes. Now, why does she ask to go glean? Because there is provision for the poor in the law of Moses. The law of Moses actually tells us what should be done for the poor. In Leviticus chapter 23, 22, it says, when you reap the harvest of your land, you're not to reap all the way to the edge of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. Leave them for the poor and the foreign resident. I am the Lord your God, Yahweh your God. And then in Deuteronomy 24, 19, it says, when you reap the harvest in your field and you forget a sheaf in the field, do not go back to get it. It's to be left for the foreigner, the fatherless, and the widow, so that the Lord your God may bless you in the work of your hands. Ruth the Moabitess, it says in Ruth 2:2, asked Naomi, will you let me go to the fields and gather fallen grain behind someone who allows me to? You see, she already understood the provision of the word of God, that you leave the corners for the poor and the foreign residents who have come and are destitute. They don't own those fields. God said, we have to care for the poor. And so in Israel's constitution, the law of Moses, this is the way they provided. They said, leave the corners, and then the poor, those who have no job, those who have no land, those who are foreign residents, who are there seeking refuge, they can go and get the grain. And so this is nothing. When Ruth asks Naomi, can I go glean? She is doing nothing but being obedient to God's word. She says, this is the provision that God has made. And so even though we have nothing, I'm going to do it. And now the point of this is that God often makes provision for our needs. There's no question that this is saying that, but all we need to do is obey his word. We need to follow what God has provided for us in his word. Someone once said to Mark Twain that he wanted to go, this man told Twain, I want to go to the land of Israel, and I want to go to the Sinai desert, and I want to go on top of Mount Sinai, and I want to recite the Ten Commandments. And Twain looked at him and said, you know, it might be better for you if you just stayed here in Boston and tried to obey them. I thought that's really exactly what this is talking about. We are sometimes in situations where we feel we are in need, and maybe the best thing to do to have those needs met by God is to just stay and obey God's word. So we're disappointed. All our needs haven't been met. Yet God wants us to obey him. Let's say a business has failed. God still wants us to work where we can. Perhaps we're disappointed because a child is not what we'd hoped for. God still wants us to love and care for that child. Maybe our marriage is strained and we're disappointed. God still wants us to obey the scriptures and love our spouses and care for them. It doesn't matter what it is. When we are disappointed, we have to say, what would God have me do in his word, and obey that? Because that's what Ruth did. That's why she went to glean. That's what we need to do. I have a friend who has a master's degree. He's got a graduate degree. He was working in radio at a high level position. And then, as you might consider in radio, things happen and he was laid off. He was let go. And it was heartbreaking for him because that was really what he wanted to do. And when he was let go, he has a wife, he has several children. He needed to have a job. And he was having a hard time finding a job in radio where he didn't have to move. He didn't want to move. He had obligations here in the state. And so what did he do? He went to one of the big box home repair stores, hardware stores, like one of those Menards or Home Depots, one of those places, and he got a job. Because he said, my job is to, my obedience to the word of God is to work. It's not to work in the field that I want. It's to work. God will provide a job for me, and I will be able to provide for my family. He was obedient to God's word rather than worrying about this has to be in my area. He was disappointed that he lost his job, but he still got a job to help his family. So the first way that God meets our needs is through obedience to his word. A second way that God meets our needs is through hard work. You can see that in what Ruth did. I mean, look at how she went to work. She worked hard in those fields. And there are three aspects that I think shows about the hard work of Ruth that we find in this passage that we can emulate, that we can follow. First of all, we must take initiative. Did you notice that in verse 2, she wasn't told by Naomi, go glean in the field? No, she wasn't told anything. What she did is she said, will you let me go? Will you let me go into the fields and gather fallen grain behind someone who allows me to? She asks her mother-in-law, let me do this for you. So she shows initiative. She wants to work. Besides showing initiative, she was industrious. We should be industrious. Did you see how she works? The text tells us how long she worked. It says that she gathered grain in the field from morning when she started until evening. She beat out what she had gathered. It was about 26 quarts of barley. That's what Ruth 2:17 says. So she was industrious. We need to be industrious, hardworking, diligent in our work. And so that's a second aspect of the kind of hard work that we have to do. And she was persistent. She worked, I think I skipped one point there for you, but she was persistent. She came and continued working from dawn until now. So she showed initiative, she was persistent, she was industrious. It says that she took out, in the Hebrew, it says she took out an ephah of barley. That's about 35 pounds or 26 quarts. Now, here's what I want to show you about this. When we need to have our needs met, we tend to become overly spiritual. We kind of lay back and we ask God to meet our needs. And we are like, oh, God, please provide for me. I'll just wait here. I know you want to do that for me. Yes, God wants to meet our needs, but he wants to do it through us doing hard work. It's being diligent. It's a matter of working according to what God has provided for us. So I love the story about the kids in the Sunday school where the Sunday school teacher is asking the kids, she said, now what is gray, has a fluffy tail, and loves nuts? And all the kids in the Sunday school class are sitting there quietly and they don't know what to say. And she says it again, you know, what's gray, has a fluffy tail, and furry tail, and it loves to eat nuts. Kids don't know. And finally, one little boy raises his hand and he says, I know the answer is Jesus, but it sure sounds like a squirrel. What we do is that we over-spiritualize. We make things to seem like, oh, we're going to just passively wait for God to meet our needs. No. Yes, Jesus will meet our needs. Yes, the Lord will meet our needs. But it has to also be through the work that he gives us to do. So, how is he going to meet our needs? First, through obedience of God's word. Second, through hard work. Here's a third way that God will meet our needs. He will meet our needs through our own personal faith. We need faith when we're going through times where we think our needs are not being met. He wants us to show faith. So what does faith involve? In Ruth's example, we see that faith involves humility. Faith involves humility about ourselves. Think about Ruth. The foreman reports to Boaz that she asked permission. Will you let me gather fallen grain behind the harvesters? Verse 7 of chapter 2. She asked permission, even though she knew it was her right according to the law of Moses. She didn't insist on her right. She asked for permission. That shows her humility. The other thing that she says when she responds to Boaz in verse 10, she recognizes her foreign status. She says, why are you being so kind to me, although I am a foreigner? She recognizes that she's not an Israelite, even though the requirements of the law was even for a foreigner, they could gather in the corners of the fields. But still, she recognizes that she can't insist on anything, and she asks for she wonders at his kindness, even though she was a foreigner. And then her response to Boaz's blessing is found in verse 13. She says to him, you've been comforting me and you have spoken kindly to your servant, though I am not one of your servants. She recognized her lower status in the community. She said, you've treated me like a servant and I'm not even a servant. I think when we have our needs and we're struggling, sometimes it's because we are demanding more than we deserve. One of the things I love about this example from Ruth is her faith is evident in her humility. She does not insist. She does not demand. She has a humble faith. Another aspect of her faith is that faith involves dependence on God. Boaz sees Ruth as a woman who depends on God. He says to her in verse 12, he says, may the Lord repay you for what you have done. May you be richly rewarded by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. It's the picture of a huge bird gathering her chicks under her arm for protection. That's what you have done with God. You have learned dependence on him, and you are trusting in him. That's her faith. It's a dependent faith in God. Now, it's crucial that we see that this shows that this chapter is not teaching that God helps those who help themselves. God helps those who obey his word. God helps those who are willing to work hard at what he has given them to do. God helps those who depend on him. We need to trust him to meet those needs. Yes, we trust God for a job, but we send out a resume. Yes, we trust God for a mate, but we have to live purely till then. Yes, we trust God for money, but we might have to make a debt reduction plan. All those things are true. But the most important aspect of this is we need to trust God to meet our needs. Years ago, I went to a school, Azusa Pacific University. There was a professor there who taught health. But then he became a famous author, Tim Hansel. And he wrote in a book called Holy Sweat the following, and I thought I would pass it on for you. He says, at first I saw God as my observer, my judge. keeping track of the things I did wrong so as to know whether I merited heaven or hell when I die. He was out there watching me, sort of, not real involved, sort of like the president. But later on, when I met Jesus, it seemed as though life were rather like a bike ride. In other words, he's no longer trying to earn his way, but he sees it as a bike ride. It was a tandem bike, and I noticed that Jesus was in the back, helping me pedal. I don't know just when it was that he suggested we change places, but life has not been the same since. When I had control, I knew the way. It was rather boring, but predictable. It was the shortest distance between two points. But when he took the lead, he knew delightful long cuts up mountains and through rocky places at breakneck speeds. It was all I could do to hang on, even though it looked like madness. He said, "Pedal." I worried and I was anxious and asked, "Where are you taking me?" He laughed and didn't answer. And I started to learn to trust. I forgot my boring life and entered into the adventure. And when I'd say, "I'm scared," he'd lean back and touch my hand. He took me to people with gifts that I needed, gifts of healing, acceptance, and joy. They gave me gifts to take on my journey, my Lord's and mine. And we were off, we were off again. He said, "Give those gifts away. They're extra baggage, too much weight." So I did, so to the people we met, and I found that in giving I received, and still our burden was light. I didn't trust him at first in control of my life. I thought he'd wreck it. But he knows bike secrets, knows how to make it bend to take sharp corners, knows how to jump to clear high rocks, knows how to fly to shorten scary passages. And I'm learning to shut up and pedal in the strangest places. And I'm beginning to enjoy the view and the cool breeze on my face with my delightful, constant companion, Jesus the Messiah. And when I'm sure I just can't do it anymore, he just smiles and says, "Pedal." That's what dependence is. That's learning to let him ride the bike. And we just pedal and follow along. So, how does God meet our needs? Through obedience to his word. He meets our needs through diligent hard work. He meets our needs also through dependent faith in him. He also meets our needs, fourthly, through his own providence. God meets our needs through God's own providence. Now, I'm throwing out a word here, providence, theology lecture. It's a big word. You know, we hear it in theological circles. I venture to say that most people think it's just a city in Rhode Island. But providence is a significant word. Here's what it means. It means God's activity in caring for his children. It's not a miracle. It's not a coincidence. It is seeming coincidences that God uses. Oh, how did that happen? Wow, what an amazing coincidence. No, it's God's operating his activity to meet our needs. That's how God provides for us, through providence. Now, in the book of Ruth, it is amazing how much providence there is. I want you to note all the providence in the book of, not all, just here in chapter 2. First of all, Ruth happened, when she went to glean, she happened to visit the field of a relative who also just happened to be a man of fine character. You see that in verse 1. It says, Naomi had a relative on her husband's side, Boaz. He was a prominent man of noble character from Elimelech's family. And so that's who she just happens to go to. It says she happened to be in the portion of the field belonging to Boaz. Wow. Ha. So verses 1 and 3, she happened to have this relative. She happened to go to his field that day. And then she happened to meet this man who was a spiritually motivated man. We know this. He's called a mighty man of valor, a man of integrity. He is also called a man of spirituality, we see, because when he gets to the field to visit, he doesn't say, "Hey guys, are you working hard?" He says, "The Lord be with you." He greeted his harvesters that way, and they respond, "The Lord bless you." This is the time of the judges when people forgot God. Boaz had not forgotten God. He happened to be a mature spiritual man. Also, he happened to show favor to Ruth. We see that in verses 8 and 9. He tells her, "Don't go and gather grain in another field, and don't leave this one, but stay here close to my female servants. See which field they're harvesting. Follow them. Haven't I ordered the young men not to touch you? When you are thirsty, go and drink from the jars the young men have filled." Basically, he's showing her special consideration. That just happened to happen. He shows her favor. It also happened to be that he was generous to her. He tells her to come and eat, and this is in verses 14 and 15. He tells her to come and to eat some of the bread and dip it in the vinegar sauce. He offered her food. She ate and was satisfied. She had some left over, and then she went to go gather grain. And then also, he tells the young men, pull out special stalks for her. Take care of her. Provide for her. But don't embarrass her. Just leave it there so she'll find it. I just think that this is wonderful when you see this, because there was no reason for Boaz to do this. It just so happened that Ruth found favor in his sight. And he's generous to her and kind to her. Here's the point. Nothing happens just by chance. God is in charge of everything. That is God's providence. He is caring for Ruth. Guess what? He will care for us. He will look out for us. And he's working things together that just seem like coincidences. When I was in graduate school, in seminary, Eva worked at the medical school, and it just so happened that she made friends with a young woman who was just a delightful young woman, and her husband was a medical student and then was a resident. Then he became one of the top oncologists in the country, and then we kind of didn't have much to do with them because we lived in different places years later. Then in our family, we were dealing with a real serious medical crisis many years ago, and we just didn't know what to do. And I thought, wait, maybe God made this connection for us. And so I called that physician, who now had a national reputation, and he said, "I know just the doctor for you. She's the number one doctor in the world. She's right there where you live. But guess what? She doesn't just take patients, but I will call her, and she will take you guys into her patient load." And that's how it happened, that doctor became our doctor. And God used that to deliver us from a terrible medical situation. But here's the point. It wasn't that it just so happened that we made friends with that couple back in graduate school. It didn't just so happen. It was God's providential care for us that we only found out the purpose of it many, many years later. See, God cares for us through his providence. He meets our needs. Sometimes it doesn't seem like he's doing it fast enough, but he is putting everything together. My friend Mike V, his favorite verse, Romans 8:28, God works all things together for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. That is God's providence. We dare never forget it. So God will meet our needs. How will he do it? Well, he'll do it through obedience to his word, through hard work. He'll do it through dependent faith, but he'll also do it through his amazing providence to care for us. There's one more way that God meets our needs, and here it is. God will meet our needs through God's people. God will meet our needs through his people. Naomi recognizes right away God's hand in the provision of Boaz. She, when Ruth comes back and reports all that has happened, she says to Naomi, or Naomi says to Ruth, "May he be blessed by the Lord, who has not forsaken his kindness to the living or the dead." Naomi continued, "That man is a close relative. He's one of our family redeemers. He is one that actually even could marry you, Ruth. That's what a kinsman redeemer is, or a family redeemer is. God has helped us through this man. Sometimes when we're needy, God uses people. Naomi recognized right away that God's hand was in bringing Boaz to them because he was going to use a person to help them. God uses his people to bring us through, to help us meet our needs. He's remarkable that way. And sometimes we want God to directly help us to meet our needs. We don't want people to get involved because we're kind of embarrassed, but yet God uses his people. It's why we're part of a community here. When I when we bought our first house, we put every penny we had into that house. We had about $500 left in our accounts after everything was done and we were able to buy our first house. We had no money, we had no reserve. It was kind of stupid. But anyway, that's what we did. And we're in the house for about a week and the washer and dryer both quit. It was gonna cost everything to fix them, and then the guy came out and said, they're not worth fixing, they're really old, why'd you buy these? So there we were, and amazingly, there was a dear attorney who loved the Lord who had been our attorney in the sale of the house and purchase of the house, and she heard about this and immediately said, I'm giving you a housewarming gift. I said, oh, no, that's okay. She said, no, I'm buying you a new washer dryer. I said, no, that's not necessary. She said, absolutely, it's what God told me to do. I didn't want her to. I was too embarrassed. She says, stop being embarrassed. This is what God wants me to do. And she met that need. I was so grateful, so grateful, but I was a little embarrassed. We need not be embarrassed. We need not be embarrassed. God meets our needs sometimes through the very people he sends our way. Well, here's the simple point, okay, of this whole chapter. The question I've asked is, how will God meet our needs? Well, this is how. If we will obey God, if we will faithfully obey, God will faithfully provide. It's not if we help ourselves, God will help us too. No. If we make ourselves totally directed towards, I will obey God no matter what in this circumstance. If that's the decision we make, he promises to faithfully provide for our needs. That's what this passage is teaching. Well, quickly, now what do we do? Now what? Well, I was thinking about a couple questions that we ask. First, why does it not always happen for us? Why doesn't it always happen in our lives? Well, I want to make three quick suggestions. One, our needs may not be real needs. We may think we have a need, but it's not real. You know, our kids may not need the latest video games or video game components. Our kids may not need a bigger house or a new car, or we may not need that. We are thinking what we have as needs, God says, you know, yeah, not really, not a real need. Secondly, our needs may already be met. God may be working to meet our needs already, and we don't even realize it. He's doing stuff to help us help us with meeting our needs. My mom said that this is the thing that she learned. My mom was a Holocaust survivor, a concentration camp survivor, and she said as she got young, got hungrier and hungrier, and when she was liberated, she weighed less than 70 pounds and had lost all her hair from malnutrition. She said that there were some people that couldn't take the brutality anymore. They couldn't take the suffering anymore, and God met their need by taking them. She said, with me, I needed to survive. And in the end, God met my needs and enabled me to survive even this brutal time. She said, God meets our needs in ways that we would never understand. She said she needed to survive and she did. Others needed relief and God took them. But our needs may be already met, but we just don't realize it. And ultimately, he met her need through liberation. Thirdly, our needs may be different than we supposed. Actually, sometimes when we are lacking something and we think we have a need, what God is trying to teach us is dependence. A man once asked a wise rabbi, "Rabbi, why doesn't God give me everything I need for the year on the first day of the year so I won't worry all year long?" And the rabbi said to him, "Well, maybe God is trying to teach you to depend on him daily, to live your life in dependence on him, working and seeing how you work and make a living." And that's what God says. Sometimes what happens is that he is wanting to give us something else that we need, dependence on him. Okay, that's the first question, which is, why doesn't it always happen? That's why. Secondly, what can I do now? What can I do now to have my needs met? I want to make three quick suggestions. First, determine what concrete steps to take. What should I do? Think I need a job? Make a resume. If you're having a health issue, make a doctor's appointment. Whatever it is that needs to be done, your marriage is struggling, maybe a night out with your wife or husband. That might be a way to take some steps right now. Second, trust the situation to the Lord through prayer. I love the description that Boaz had of Ruth, that she'd taken refuge under God's wings. That's trusting God. Rick Warren often says, if we want to know what we're trusting God for, ask what we're praying about most regularly. If we are faithful, if we are praying about something regularly, that's what we're trusting God for. So trust God, learn dependence on God, commit it to him in prayer. Trust the situation to the Lord through prayer. And third, look for God's hand working in our lives. Look for God's providence. He's going to use it. He's going to actually make things come together. He will make things work together for good. When the situation begins to resolve, you'll be able to see that what we thought were coincidences were not coincidences. What they were was God's hand working all things together for good. One of my favorite scenes in The Princess Bride, which has many, I think we quote that movie more than any other in our family, but there's the scene when Wesley has been mostly dead for most of the day, and he's coming back, and they're going to storm the castle, and he asks, "Well, what do we have? What's our inventory?" And they start mentioning things. He says, "No one mentioned we had a Holocaust cloak." I love that, the way he takes inventory. So here's what I want to suggest. Let's take inventory. What has God given us to meet our needs? He's provided resources, including our minds, our tools, our abilities to meet our needs. What he wants us to do is obey him so those can be released in our lives. This is the simple message of Ruth 2. God will meet our needs if we faithfully obey him. If we obey him faithfully, God will meet our needs. Let's pray together. Lord God, thank you that you do meet our needs, that you do care, and that you're working with your invisible hand to make everything come together for good. Oh God, help us to be faithfully obedient to you, to your word, and then open our eyes to see how you are working. And we pray this in the name of our Messiah Jesus. Amen.
Worship you. You are here. you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
My God, my God,
that is who you are.
You are Waymaker,
miracle worker,
promise keeper,
light in the darkness.
My God, God,
that is who you are. You are here,
touching every heart.
I worship you,
God, I worship you.
You are here, healing every heart.
I worship you, God, I worship you.
You are here, turning lives around. I worship you.
I do.
Oh, I worship you.
You are here,
lifting every heart. I worship you.
I worship you.
Oh, you are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
My God,
that is who you are.
You are
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
My God,
that is who you are.
You are. That's who.
Such a powerful message from Ruth 2 from Dr. Rydelnik today. We invite you to read Ruth 3 before next Sunday to prepare your heart for the next message in the series, Finding Hope in a Disappointing World. We hope you'll join us this Thursday at our Rolling Meadows campus for worship night starting at 7:30 p.m. Or you can meet us online at harvestbiblechapel.org. We want to invite you back next Sunday morning at 9 and 11 o'clock Central Time. And know you are loved.